All right. Well, good morning, church. Hey, we're happy to have you to join us this morning to worship our Heavenly Father. And especially, too, as we move into Holy Week, we are just so grateful that you're here because we're going to be able to celebrate what Jesus has done for us on the cross. So why don't we stand up as we praise the name of the Lord together. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Cause when we see you, cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us. Worthy of all our praise. Hosanna, Hosanna, worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging seas. My God, He holds the victory. Destroy in the house of the Lord. Destroy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. Destroy in the house of the Lord. Our God is sure in this place. We won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. Oh, oh, we'll shout out your praise. God who hears, we sing to the God who saves, we sing to the God who always makes a way. Cause He hung up on that cross, and He rose up from that grave, my God still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord, there's joy in the house of the Lord today, we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is sure in this day. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven. Accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
Come on!
We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord today.
Come on.
And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We're gonna shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. Our God is showing me this way. That we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. Oh, 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 we shout out your praise. There is joy in this house. There is joy in this house today. Oh, 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 we shout out your praise. We shout out. I believe there were wonders and signs, and you're still the same. I believe every word that you said. I believe there are scars in your hands. That your goodness is good without end, and you'll never change. Tell of your wonders, sing of your grace. The God of creation knows me by name. The Lord is faithful, yesterday, now, and always. Always. Your mercy is mighty, age after age, and all generations
We'll bow down and praise. The Lord is faithful. Yesterday, now, and always. I know there is power, the power to sing.
Sing this out.
I will tell of your wonders, sing of your grace. The God of creation knows me by name. The Lord is faithful, yesterday, now, and always. Oh, yeah. Your mercy is mine, age after age. All generations will bow down and praise. The Lord is faithful, yesterday, now, and always. Oh, yes,
you are.
You are. You are. And you always will be God.
Come on. Lord, we know that you are the same yesterday, today, and always. Lord, as we look at what you've done in our lives already, we know that we are able to worship you this morning, knowing that you have come through and that you will always come through. Lord, we'd have no reason to sing this morning if it wasn't for the work that you've done for us on the cross. We'd have no reason to worship. We'd have no reason to praise you. If Jesus were to stay in that grave, Father, why would we be here today? This would all be meaningless. But yet, Lord, your Son rose again 3 days later so that way we could have life in you. So, Lord, this morning I pray that we would just remember that. Remember the reason why we sing. Remember the purpose of our worship. But, Lord, help us to honor you and glorify you with our lives. Amen.
Amen. Hey, go ahead and be seated. We've got a little video to make you aware of VBS coming soon.
Five, four, three, two, one.
Fuzzy command to internal.
Engines off. Opening main door. Wow! This is amazing! Look, over there! Let's go!
Jesus is the in my heart, even when the
one of the important ministries in our church is Vacation Bible School for the Kids. It's coming in June at the end of the month, on 26th through the 30th. And we're just now getting the information out. And we want you to know that starting tomorrow, you can register your kids, your grandkids. And we hope that you will. You can do that online. Also, we have some information in the back. If you want to be a volunteer leader, and we need probably 40 or 50 of you, then you can contact Lisa back there. We also have some yellow stars. Those are ways for you to help provide some things that will offset the cost of VBS. We like to keep the cost as low as possible for the kids so when they come that they can afford to be here, their parents can afford to put them in. So see Lisa back there when it's over, but we're excited about VBS this year. It's Stellar Shine Jesus Light. All right, kids, you're free to go to Children's Church. Take off. There you go. All right. So I want to introduce myself to you. If you're a visitor here today, I'm Carrie Bauman, and I'm one of the pastors at River Ridge Church, and we're grateful to have the opportunity to minister to you. And so we just want to help you grow. That's why we exist. The church exists to glorify God and love others to Christ, and that's what we want to do. And so that's what our prayer is, and we want to help you be everything that God has called you to be. So I'm a disciple of Jesus. A disciple means a learner. Someone who learns from Christ about life. And so I'm trying to grow in my relationship with God, and I hope that all of you are too. We say to people when you come, worship, grow, serve, and share. Worship the Lord regularly. Grow in your faith. Serve the Lord in ministry. And share your faith with others that they might know about your Lord Jesus. So we hope you'll do that. If you're new to the church, we have a couple of opportunities for you to make yourself known. There's two cards. One is kind of a large one, and it's to give us information if you're thinking that River Ridge is going to be your church. Then fill that out, and we'll add your information to the database, and we'll make sure that you receive all the information about anything going on in the church. The smaller one is if you're a visitor, and you're just saying, you know, I don't know where we're at with this, but I want to let you know I'm here, and I would appreciate it if you just give me a call, Pastor, have some questions, just want to learn more about the church. Fill that out. Just leave them. They're both out in the Welcome Center when you leave on your right. Fill that out and leave it there, and we'll pick it up. You'll notice that today is the first Sunday of the month, first Sunday, but we're not having communion. It's usually right here behind me, but we're not doing it today because Friday is Good Friday, and we will have communion on Good Friday. And this is Holy Week for Christians. It starts with Palm Sunday when we celebrate the triumphal entry of Jesus Christ into Jerusalem. They waved palm branches and cried out, Hosanna, Hosanna to the Son of David. And so we're going to talk about that more today. Friday, we're going to have a Good Friday service. It's at 6 o'clock, and we hope to pack this place. And you need to make it a part of your Easter celebration. It sets the tone for the celebration we have on Sunday morning because we'll look at the passion of Christ and the suffering on the cross, and we'll leave in a kind of a somber silence, knowing that when we come back Sunday morning, that we'll be coming back to say the Lord is risen. He is risen indeed. We worship a risen Savior. So that's all going to take place Good Friday at 6 o'clock here in the normal hours, 9 and 11. I hope you're inviting your friends and neighbors. We'll have plenty of seating for everybody and for Easter, and I think it's going to be a great celebration. So I hope you can make that. Well, you know, one of the things that pastors do is we pray for our congregations. And I want you to know something. I don't just pray for you on Sunday morning. I pray for you through the week, too. But it's my privilege to be able to pray for our church on Sundays. And so I want to do that now. Would you bow your heads and join me as we go before the Lord? Well, Father, we thank you that you are good all the time. And you're the same yesterday, now, and always. Lord, that's so encouraging, and we think about if you weren't the same, if you changed, if one moment you loved us and the next you didn't, if one moment you chose to save us by the blood of Christ and the next you didn't. But I thank you that your promises are true, and Lord, that you are not a man that you should change your mind, nor the Son of Man, Lord, that you should alter your opinion. So we thank you that you do what you say you're going to do, and we praise you this morning, Father, for that. Thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, whom you sent into the world to die on the cross for our sin. This is the week when we especially focus on that. And Lord, the great price that he paid in separation from you, Father, that he would be willing to do that on the cross of Calvary so that we who were dead in our trespasses and sins could be made alive in Christ. So we honor you this morning. We thank you for that, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. The scripture says you were obedient to the point of death on the cross. And Lord, we celebrate, we look forward next Sunday celebrating the resurrection, that on that first day of the week when the ladies went to the tomb, it was empty. And the angel said, he is risen. And so, Father, today we pray and invite you to speak to us about the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. We pray that you will help us to understand what that means for every one of us and what you're calling us to. We pray for those in our church this morning who are suffering, who are brokenhearted, and there are many, Lord, people who have experienced the passing of a loved one, and we just pray your comfort and ministry upon them. So, Lord, please hear our prayers and answer them according to your good, perfect, and acceptable will. Pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
A thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the land. And all who've gone before us, and all who will believe, will sing the song of ages to the land. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy. Song forever to the land. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the land. Oh, we sing the song forever.
Your name stands above.
Hey, stay standing, would you please? We're going to read the Bible together. And here at River Ridge Church, we try to honor the Lord when we do so. So I'm going to read to you from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 9 through 19. And it's about that first Palm Sunday and Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. But it starts with something that happened just prior to that. It says, when the large crowd of the Jews learned that Jesus was there, it was in Bethany, a town not too far from Jerusalem, they came not only on account of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well, because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. The next day, the large crowd that had come to the feast heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, crying out, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel. And Jesus found a young donkey, and he sat on it, just as it is written, Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. His disciples did not understand these things at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written about him and had been done to him. The crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to bear witness. The reason why the crowd went to meet him was that they had heard that he had done this sign. And so the Pharisees said to one another, You see that you are gaining nothing. Look, the whole world has gone after him. Please be seated. So Bill and Ned were friends, and they hung out together and did like most friends. They would occasionally go to breakfast. One day they went to breakfast. Bill ordered his meal from the cashier, and then Ned stepped up to order his, and the cashier said, Hello, Ned, how are you? Hey, everybody, Ned's here. And everyone in the restaurant got up and greeted him. And Bill and Ned sat down, and Bill said to his friend, Well, Ned, you're pretty popular. And he said, Well, I don't mean to brag, but I'm actually the most popular man in the world. And he said, Now, Ned, you're pretty popular, but you're not the most popular man in the world. Oh, yeah, Ned said, I'll bet you $1,000 that I'm friends with anybody that you can name. That's so, said Bill. Well, how about the President of the United States? Ned looked at him and said, Let's go. And so the two flew to Washington, took a cab to the White House, where after a phone call by the Secret Service, they were admitted into the residence. Soon thereafter, the President came out of his office to greet them. Ned, how are you doing? I haven't seen you in ages. And after a short visit, the three of them went out to play a round of golf together. Well, that was luck, said Bill. 2,000 says you're not friends with the Queen of England. Okay. So then they flew to Buckingham Palace, and sure enough, they were greeted by the Queen. Hello, Nin, my boy. What have you been up to these days? After sharing a spot of tea with her, they left. Frustrated, Bill said, All right, double or nothing. You don't know the Pope. He said, Okay, let's go. So they took off for Rome. When they arrived at the Vatican, Ned instructed Bill to wait outside and watch. In just a little bit, Ned planned to walk out on the balcony with his arm around the Pope. About 15 minutes later, a crowd gathered to hear the Pope speak, and just as Ned had promised, when His Holiness came out, there was Ned standing beside him with his arms around the Pope's shoulders. It was then that Ned looked down from the balcony and saw that his good friend Bill had passed out on the ground. But being a good friend, he hurried down to check on him. Bill, Bill, wake up. Bill opened his eyes and said, Ned, Ned, you really are the most popular man in the world. He said, I told you that, Bill. But you didn't faint when you discovered I knew the President. And you didn't faint when I proved I knew the Queen. Bill said, I have to admit I was shocked that you knew the President, even more so the Queen. As for the Pope, well, what can I say? But I just couldn't take it when the guy next to me tapped me on the shoulder and said, Hey, who's that guy up there with Ned? You'll tell it later. You know, for most of his time in ministry, Jesus kind of wanted to remain obscure. He didn't necessarily try to draw attention to himself. You can see it when he spoke to two blind men and he healed them. And after healing them, he said in Matthew 9, See that no one knows about it. He wasn't necessarily trying to publicize his ministry at this point. At another time, he heals the daughter of a synagogue ruler, and it says he strictly charged them that no one should know this. But when you get to this morning's passage that I just read to you from John chapter 12, and we think about the Lord's triumphal entry into Jerusalem, it's clear that Jesus is now unconcerned with his rising popularity. He has descended the Mount of Olives. I've been in his path. I've walked this route, and you come down and go through the Garden of Gethsemane and then down through the Valley of Gehenna and up into Jerusalem. And as he's making his way, people are lining the way and they're calling out all kinds of nice things to Jesus. And it's as if he turned the tide and decided that now was the time for his public ministry. And so as he does this, it strikes different people who are witnessing it in different ways. The chief priests and the Pharisees, they encounter it in one particular way, the crowds in another, and even the disciples in still another. And this morning, I just want to spend a little bit of time looking at how each of these groups took in the events of the day in Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and then we'll draw some conclusions from it. So let's start first with the crowds. They were curious about Christ. It says, when the large crowd of the Jews learned that Jesus was in Bethany, Bethany was a town not too far from Jerusalem, it's where he had raised Lazarus from the dead, they came not only on account of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised. And the chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well, because on account of Lazarus, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. So the next day, the large crowd that had come to the feast, that'd be the Feast of Passover, heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, crying out, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel. Now, Jesus did a lot of miracles during his 3 years of ministry, but none greater than really raising the dead. And obviously, the fact that he had raised his friend Lazarus from the dead was a major miracle. I mean, how often does that kind of thing happen? The last time our Lord did it, he had raised the daughter of a man named Jairus. And in that case, he didn't want anyone else to know about it. But now things have changed. Our Lord doesn't seem to care who knows that he has raised Lazarus. Obviously, word has spread, so the Jews are coming from all over the place to see Jesus, because they have heard from eyewitness testimony that this guy named Lazarus was dead, buried 4 days, put in a tomb, and then Jesus said, come forth, and he did. So why did they come? Well, this event in raising Lazarus from the dead signaled to them that he was more than just a rabbi. Only two people in the Old Testament ever raised someone from the dead. And it's the two, perhaps the greatest prophets in the history of Israel, Elijah and Elisha. And so the crowds now know that, and they're witnessing in Bethany that Jesus has raised Lazarus from the dead. And so at very least, he has to be considered a great prophet like Elijah, like Elisha. That's why when he descended the Mount of Olives, they took palm branches and waved them to mark his entry into Jerusalem. By the way, that was an ancient tradition that tended to mark the great triumph of a Roman general when he came back after conquering another army, and they would wave palm branches and celebrate him coming back as he did. It's not unlike what you find in Revelation chapter 7 when Christ is celebrated for saving his people. Listen to this. After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number from every nation, from all the tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. So the same kind of thing that John was describing that he saw as a vision in heaven is happening in here in Jerusalem. In John chapter 12, it's recorded for us. And the people are calling, Hosanna, Hosanna, the word means give salvation now. And blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. It's a quote from the Old Testament, from Psalm 118. And rabbis in Jesus' day used it to refer to the coming Messiah. And as if to leave no doubt about all the things that were taking place in the crowd's collective minds, they conclude with this: blessed is the King of Israel. So don't miss it. The Jews are starting to change their opinion of Jesus. And they're starting to wonder if he, in fact, is their Messiah, and he's finally come home. So there's another issue. They know that Jesus is more than a rabbi, and they know that Lazarus is living proof of that. In raising him from the dead, Jesus had demonstrated power over life and death. So Mary and Martha were two friends of Jesus. Their brother was Lazarus, and Jesus had called him forth from the grave, and when he did so, confirmed that he had authority over death and the grave. And there was no other really plausible explanation for it than that Jesus was much more than a man. And if you notice the reaction to the Pharisees to Lazarus, the Bible says they were making plans to kill Lazarus. Why kill Lazarus? First of all, you got to wonder two things. One is, why kill him? And the other is, would he really remain dead? Jesus just raised him from the grave. Wouldn't Jesus just do it again if he wanted to? Why kill Lazarus? Well, it says that on account of him, many were coming to believe in Jesus. Now, I don't think they were coming to saving faith in Jesus. They were coming to see him differently, to believe that he was more than maybe they first accredited him to be. And so they were curious. Their belief, admittedly, was fickle because just a few days later, the same crowd who says believes in him calls out and says, crucify him, crucify him. But reality is, they're curious about who Jesus is. Is he, in fact, the long-awaited conquering king who's finally come to overthrow the enemies of Israel and set his people free? They're just curious. There's another response. Comes from the disciples, and they were confused. Verse 14, Jesus found a young donkey, and he sat on it, just as it is written, fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. His disciples, it says, did not understand these things at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things had been written about him and had been done to him. So this passage is a quotation from the Old Testament of Zechariah 9:9. And it says this, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, on the foal of a donkey. Jesus, as he began to make his way into Jerusalem, the Bible doesn't necessarily tell you the exact sequence of events. It's possible he could have walked a ways, and then in fulfillment of the prophecy, they brought him a donkey that he sat on as he headed towards the holy city. However, it played out, the report that Jesus rode on a donkey immediately after the crowd cheered him as their king probably put some sort of damper on the people, because that isn't what they would have expected at all. When a conquering general came into a city celebrating this great victory, he rode on a war horse. He rode on something that showed his status and that he had just come from vanquishing their foes and that he was someone great. Jesus comes into Jerusalem and he's not riding one. He's riding a donkey. And it changes the imagery of the whole thing. And instead of maybe whipping the people into even more of a revolutionary frenzy, it sobers them a little bit. Here's why. If you read the next two verses in Zechariah 9, it says this, I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken, and he will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. And as for you, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will free your prisoners from the waterless pit. Let me just point out three quick things from that two verses. The first is this prophecy of the coming of a gentle king brings with him cessation of war, not the beginning of one. And so he wasn't what they thought the Messiah would be, someone to overthrow their oppressors. The coming of the gentle king is also associated with a proclamation of peace, not only to Israel, but to all the nations, extending his reign to the very ends of the earth. And thirdly, the coming of the gentle king is associated with the blood of God's covenant that spells release for the captives. Now we know today, as we look back on that event, that that blood is the blood of Jesus Christ that was shed for us on the cross to help pay the penalty for our sin, to cover our sin with his righteousness, and to break the power of sin in our lives so that we can live a life that honors and pleases God. But they didn't quite understand that. They didn't see it. They were confused, the disciples were. And so it says that they didn't understand it until Jesus was glorified. That means that time when he was ascended to heaven and sat down at the right hand of the Father, that's when it began to click. But prior to that, they're taking all of this in, and they're just confused by it. They don't understand it. Then there's the Pharisees. They were conflicted. It says, the crowd that had been with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead continued to bear witness. The reason why the crowd went to meet him was that they had heard that he had done this sign. So the Pharisees said to one another, you see that you are gaining nothing. Look, the whole world has gone after him. Look, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law wanted the Messiah to come as much as anyone. But they didn't see Jesus as the Messiah. In their minds, he was anything but a deliverer. He was too meek, too lowly for that. That's why they began to make plans to kill Lazarus, because they wanted to squelch this movement that seemed to be gaining some momentum as people were cheering Jesus coming into Jerusalem. It says in John 11, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered the council and said, what are we to do? For this man, he's performing signs. And if we let him go on like this, well, everybody's going to believe in him. And the Romans will come and take away our place in our nation. It was Caiaphas, who was the high priest at the time, who said, you know nothing at all, nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people, not that the whole nation should perish. The Bible says he did not say this of his own accord, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the nation. And not for the nation only, but also to gather into one the children of God who are scattered abroad. So from that day on, they made plans to put Jesus to death. The Pharisees were ready and willing to serve a Messiah who came the way they envisioned him to come, on a war horse, coming to cast off their oppressors. They at least had to figure, well, come on, this is going to go better for us. We're not going to lose status. We're going to gain status and authority under that kind of a Messiah. So they were all for it. But the curiosity of the crowds and everything that was happening, well, that changed things for them. You know, at Passover in Jerusalem, every year, Jews come from all over, and the city swells to 10, 20 times its normal size, and that's what happened there. And they heard the cries of the crowd, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel. And as hopeful as these words were to the average Jew, they were not hopeful to the Pharisees, to the chief priests. They were not interested in following Jesus. They wanted a kingdom for themselves, and if that meant crucifying Jesus, then so be it. So they were conflicted. Sure, they wanted the Messiah, but a Messiah of their own making, of their own imagination. So you have three responses. You have the curiosity of the crowds, the confusion of the disciples, and the internal conflict of the Pharisees. Which one of these is the right one? None of them. You know what the right response to Jesus in his triumphal entry coming into Jerusalem is? Faith. Faith. To place our faith in this one who is coming in to ultimately die on the cross for our sin. That is the right response. And let me say three things about faith. Faith in Christ is always the intended outcome of a sign. You can read it in the Gospel of John. The Bible says this in John 20. Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and by believing have life in his name. So whenever Jesus did a miracle, it wasn't just some sort of novel thing that he did because people wanted some entertainment. In fact, when people asked him to do a sign, he said, an evil and adulterous generation seeks a sign. The truth is, when he did a miracle, it was never for the sake of the miracle. It was to point to himself as the one sent from God to deliver his people and the world from their sin. That's why he came. Jesus was the intended outcome of the sign of raising Lazarus from the dead, that he wanted people to know that he really was the Son of God. So there was an outcome. Secondly, faith in Christ does not require omniscience. True, the disciples didn't understand everything. There was a lot they didn't get. It says they didn't understand it too much later. But one thing they could do at that time was believe. Here's what Jesus said to them in John 14. Don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Believe in me. Believe in me. And so he's saying, I get it. You don't understand everything. And you won't till much later. But what you can do is you can believe. You don't have to know everything to have faith. I just want to say that to you. If you're sitting here today and you're thinking, you know what? There's a lot about questions I have about Christianity. There's a lot I don't understand. I get it. There isn't a person sitting here who didn't have questions about it when they gave their lives to Jesus Christ. There's a lot we didn't know, and there's still stuff that we're all learning together. I get it, but you don't have to know everything to have faith. The disciples just had to make a choice. Would they put their faith and trust in Jesus? Would they believe that he was their deliverer or not? And that same choice comes to every one of us. What will we choose? So faith is the intended outcome of any sign that Jesus did. Faith doesn't require omniscience. One more. Faith is impossible without submission. You can't say, oh yeah, yeah, okay, I get it. There's Jesus, watch him. He's coming down the hill right now. See that? He is the Messiah of God. Yep, yep, yep. I'm not going to follow him, but I know that he's the Messiah of God. That's not faith. Faith is saying, I understand that you are who you claim to be, and I choose to bow my head and my heart and to worship you and follow you as Savior and Lord. It requires that we submit to Jesus Christ. That takes faith. That takes courage. So as we begin Holy Week today, it's a time of reflection about Christ, and it starts with his triumphal entry, and of course it's going to go to his trial and crucifixion and finish with his resurrection. But I want to ask you, where are you at in all this? Are you still curious like the crowds, just kind of wondering what it is that you should think about Jesus? Maybe you're confused like the disciples and it's just not clear. Or maybe you're conflicted like the Pharisees because, frankly, you don't want to bow your head and your heart to anybody. I get it. But the right response, men and women, is always faith. It's always to trust in Jesus. That's what he calls us to. If you're sitting here today and you're saying, you know, Pastor, I never thought of that before. I do now, and I'm grateful. I want to put my faith in Jesus in the way that you're talking about. It's a simple thing. Christ says this in Revelation 3. He says, I stand at the door to your heart and I knock. And if you hear my voice and you open that door, I will come into you and I'll be with you and you can be with me. All you got to do is open the door. Someone described it to me when I was young as a door that has no handle on the outside, only on the inside. So I'm the only one who can open that door. But if I do, he says, I'll come. You just have to have the faith to believe it. Do you believe that Jesus is your Savior? Invite him in today. You'll find his promises to be true. In April of 1988, the Evening News reported about a photographer who was a skydiver. I've been skydiving. It's really cool. And when I did it, I did a tandem. So I was strapped to the back of someone else. And one thing I didn't know that was going to happen was just before I went to jump out, this other guy kind of cut in front of us. And I'm thinking, hey, wait your turn, buddy. And as he jumps out, and he had a camera strapped to him. And I thought, what are you doing? And then the guy I was going to jump with, he said, Kerry, don't worry, let him go. He's going to film us. I said, oh, really? He said, yeah, one of your friends paid for this. He's going to film us. I said, cool. And so I jumped out. You know, you're falling at 120 miles an hour, so your face is all contorted and everything looks weird. But I'm falling, and that's what this guy was doing. He was a photographer, and he was filming skydivers as they were coming out of the plane, and he was enjoying his role, and everything was fine until he was done filming. And it says he went to open his chute, and that's when the picture went berserk. The announcer who was reporting the incident said that the cameraman had fallen to his death, having jumped out of the plane and forgot his parachute. It wasn't until he reached for the absent ripcord, which is like right here, that he realized he was free falling without one. Until that point, the jump probably seemed exciting and fun, but sadly, he had acted with thoughtless haste and deadly foolishness, and nothing could save him, for his faith was in a parachute that had never been buckled on. So it is with faith in anything but Christ. If you put your faith in yourself, put your faith in your own ideas about God, you'll find that that chute will never hold you, and you're going to fall to your death. It's only when you put your faith in Jesus Christ that you'll know it's well placed. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this opportunity to consider the triumphal entry. And we want to be people of faith. We want to trust you. We understand the crowds and the disciples and the Pharisees and how they responded, but we want to respond with trust. And so we just turn our heads and our hearts to you. We bend our wills to you. We bend our knees to you. We call you Savior and Lord this morning. And we thank you that your blood covers our sin. And we pray these things in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Light, till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes.
To
Thank you.
stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels started on for the souls of all who had come to the Father on the stone. And the church of Christ was born, then the Spirit made the flame. Now this gospel truth of all shall not be, shall not be. In His name, it is free, am I here free? For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Real quickly, I have a few announcements for you. So we've got Feed My Starving Children coming on April 15th. We're looking for 121 people. Right now we have 87. But did my math correctly, that means that we need 34 more to pack that place out. And that's what I want to do with River Ridge people. So if you're available and can sign up online with us, go to our River Ridge online website. You can sign up, come be a part of it. If we have 121 people, we're going to make 40,000 meals for children around the world, and you're going to be a part of that. So I hope you'll be able to come sign up. Next, don't forget Holy Week, all the events taking place, especially this Friday with Good Friday. And then Sunday, next Sunday, 9 and 11, we'll have plenty of seating for everybody. Invite your family, your friends, and we worship a risen Savior. Also, River Ridge Softball, we have two teams this year as we did last year. If you enjoy softball, you're 17 or over, you're welcome to play. You can sign up on our website at riverridge.online. And then one more thing. We want to let you know that one of our own, Vic Tussey, went home to be with the Lord this week. So Sherry, many of you know her. She's a chaplain and a great lady. We love her dearly. And Vic was a good, very blessed man. As a matter of fact, as he was laying in the hospital in his last moments, he wrote out John chapter 13. On a dry erase board and was sharing it because he couldn't talk, but he was sharing that scripture with the people around him. Well, he went home, and it's kind of a bittersweet time because obviously he's home with the Lord where we all want to be, but we miss him, and we want to comfort his wife, Sherry. So just want you to know that. Now please receive the benediction. Oh, and right after this service, Lori is going to have a choir rehearsal for Good Friday and Easter. So if we could kind of a little more quickly make our way out today, she would be grateful. And if not, you face her wrath, not me. No, I'm kidding. But please receive the benediction. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. Amen. God bless you. Go in peace and serve the Lord.